Downward Spiral is a really important album to me. It was my first Nine Inch Nails album. It is my favorite Nine Inch Nails album. And I discovered it when I was coming out of a really dark time in my teenage years. And I would listen to this song, I Do Not Want This, on repeat, just over and over again, tears streaming down my face. I felt like this song was about my pain, not like it wasn't about other people's pain, but there was like something about the message, but also just the sound of the song. It was like a sonic illustration of how I felt. And when I listen to this song still to this day, I feel kind of instantly transported back to that place, back to those feelings, and it's pretty intense. There's a very cyclical, repetitive, kind of relentless quality to this song in my experience. Sort of like, it won't give up, it wants me dead, goddamn this noise inside my head, like evolved into this. You know, it continued and it became this thing that just will not let up, will not leave me alone, won't stop, the noise in my head, I do not want this. I think a lot of that has to do with the drums, which we'll talk about more in a second, but they don't let up. They start right away and they don't stop until right before the last word. And so it's just always there, sort of like a heartbeat, but not in a comforting way in any way to me. It's more like I'm trapped in this cage, I'm stuck, I can't get out, this thing won't leave me alone, it just won't stop. There's also something really visceral about the experience I have when I listen to this song, like it gets inside of me, like it bypasses the intellectual completely, like take away the lyrics for now, just the way it sounds. It's like it's in my memories, it's in my blood. It goes straight to my nervous system. And so I feel powerless to it and the way it sort of throws me around with the different changes and the sort of the big and small, I'm sorry, the sort of big and small feelings that happen. Like I'm very entranced, but I'm also like gripped. Like, you know, I can't stop it. I want to talk about the way this song starts. At first, the drums are sort of split into two tracks. So on the left, you just kind of hear tick-a-doon, tick-a-doon, ch, tick-a-doon, tick-a-doon, ch. And then in the second half of the verse, the kicks get to both channels and they're so distorted and heavy. And it would just feel like kind of a gut punch when that would happen. Well, you know how this world can beat you down. The other interesting thing is that there's no bass line at first. So it's just his voice, just these drums and this, which we now know to be sort of disorienting. So it just feels exactly like I'm losing ground. That is so literal. And it would just, again, this is part of why I think it's so evocative, because he's giving us a message. And maybe this, again, I don't know what his intention was, but whatever he's trying to communicate, it seems to be coming at me from all directions. And then when the chorus starts, it just feels like we're like pushed into the ground. Don't you tell me how I feel. Don't you tell me how I feel. Don't you tell me how I feel. You don't know just how I feel. When I sat down to analyze the song, the first thing that I wanted to figure out was the piano, because those piano melodies have been haunting me for 20 years. And when I finally played it, it was pretty intense. The way that that sounded, especially back then, was just different. It was so listless. It felt like there was no tonal center. I didn't know where I was, and yet it was beautiful, and it was ugly, and it was uncomfortable, and it was comforting. If I try to analyze these chords with music theory, the only thing I can really come up with is an inverted half diminished seventh chord. So here's what that half diminished seventh chord sounds like without any changes made to it. the first one, and the second one. So if we take this chord, this D is on the top, and we bring it down here. So now it's inverted. But then I take out the third, which is the G. This is what I'm left with. However, I don't really hear it like that. I don't really hear it as anything that I can recognize and then reorder. And it repeats. So this, that whole thing repeats just a whole step down, which I didn't even realize. I just knew that they both had tritones in them. D to B flat, D to A flat. Just that sound, that super unstable, kind of awkward closed-in sound. But yeah, it's just exactly the same thing, except the second time he brings a little bit more of a sense of orientation and humanity in my experience by going like this. That would be a fifth above where we're kind of oriented at that point, which is in D. It's just for a moment though, right? Ending here, and then we hear that seventh, that beautiful minor seventh that's all over the song, all over Trent Reznor's music, and arguably my favorite interval. It's probably a huge reason why I love Nine Inch Nails so much, to be honest. It's that one little thing. So this kind of repeating pattern, it could just keep going. Isn't that beautiful and strange? Side note, at this time I was in high school and I was studying music. I've been playing music for probably 10 years, but I think the Trent Reznor was like the primary delivery method of tritones in my life. And I was listening to metal, but I feel like those tritones were kind of buried in the low end, you know, like and stuff. And so it would add to the mood, but it wouldn't like sound like a tritone like this. This is just so upfront and in your face, and so it just sounded really strange to me. But I'd be curious to know, like, do you feel disoriented by this? But the fact that it can just sort of shift around and still feel the same is sort of evidence that it doesn't really have a center. It doesn't really have a point of gravity. But there is actually a tonal center. It's just sort of obscured, especially at the beginning, with just this. I do get the sense that it's an E just because of this bottom note, which is then repeated up here. But that tritone is very disorienting. And then it goes here. But his voice is giving us some clues. It always sounded to me like he was singing a melody that I could hold on to, that was more recognizable, that had a tonal center, but he's singing it on top of this, which doesn't really feel like that. And there's a lot of dissonance between what he's singing and what he's playing. So much so that it made me think maybe he wrote the melody, his vocal melody, before he came up with this, and then he put this underneath and was like, ooh. So since I can't separate the vocals and the piano in my mix, I'm just gonna play and sing it for you here so you can hear what it sounds like without this underneath it. I'm losing ground. Well, you know how this world can beat you down. I'm I'm the only one who thinks this way. What a beautiful melody that is. So it's, you know, that has a tonal center. It's clearly E, but just over the piano, it's just like, I mean, I don't even know how he would reliably sing that over the piano because it really kind of messes with your head. I'm losing ground. Well, you know how this world can beat you down. That was hard. You know, my voice wanting to kind of like match up with the notes, like this flat five. Singing this, I'm. And that, I think, is so powerful. I think that's a big part of what makes the song feel the way it does to me. Something I can recognize on top of something that I can't. Something that normally I would feel grounded by, that I could hold on to, that keeps slipping away because of this. And this other, and this just sucking me in over and over again. This part of his vocal melody always hit me so hard. And don't tell me that you care. Don't tell me that you care. There really isn't anything now, is there? I do not want this. Now, if you might be noticing that there's a lot of this. And that's the four resolving to the major three, or like kind of a sus four feeling. That's something that he does in a lot of his music, a lot in this album. Doesn't it make you feel better? I do not want this. I don't know if I could say that this is actually like a melodic motif that repeats, because he does that in other albums. It's really just two notes, and it's a very common type of resolution. But still, every time it happens, there is a little bit of a feeling of familiarity. Now, I mentioned that he does some kind of jazzy exploration with the piano, which would just, oh my gosh, it would always just tug at my heartstrings. Just the tinkly sound of the piano, and me being a pianist, of course, every time I heard the piano, I felt a sense of familiarity personally. But I really love what he did up here, and I remember thinking like, gosh, this guy's a genius. The piano in this song reminds me more of jazz tonality than Western tonal harmony in a lot of ways. It sounds more exploratory and experimental. It gives me that feeling that there are like no wrong notes. And later on, he sort of improvises on the piano and brings in some other tones, a lot of the fourth degree. I do not want this. I do not want this. I do not want this. And this being the fourth, and this being the seventh, both of those are unstable intervals and scale degrees. They are tense, but not incredibly dissonant. They don't sound nearly as dissonant, though, as like a minor second, or a tritone, or a major seventh. That minor seventh, ooh, it's just edgy, but it's just open enough to sound more pleasing. And it's also interesting to hear the fourth, because the fourth can sound a lot like a fifth. It has a similar open quality, but when you put it on top of the whole context, it has tension. It wants to resolve down or up or something. This being a tonic, oh gosh, do you hear how good that sounds? To break out into an improv. Anyway, my point is that he's vacillating between unstable intervals in his scale. I should really say unstable scale degrees in his music, and it just adds to that disorienting feeling, but it's still so beautiful. Let's listen to some of the more tonal elements of the song that come in that really do ground us in the key of E something. There's a bass line that comes in and it sounds, oh, so satisfying. It's not super far up in the mix, you know, it's not like incredibly obvious, but it reminds me a little bit, I think, of the synth bass line in Heresy and in Ruiner. It's just really satisfying. And it's pretty much just playing the tonic. And I think there are some flat sevens in there as well. It's also syncopated, so it's like offset. Interesting to find out, like, if he wrote something that was on the beat and then shifted it afterwards, because I've done things like that when I'm composing, like, this needs something, and I'll just offset it by a whole beat or by a 16th note or an 8th note and see what that sounds like. Syncopation typically does sound more interesting to us. The other thing that really grounds us in E is his ahs and his oohs. Every time I hear these oohs and ahs, like, I have to sing along to them, and they remind me of, like, those voices that are coming in from, like, here and here, those different parts of me or parts of him, the Mr. Self-Destruct, the parts of him that are trying to control him and take over and are mocking him. Listen also to what's happening underneath his vocals in the chorus. The chugging, the going all the way down, that drop, that octave. It's just very menacing. It's very clearly, though, in E. Like, this is all E. So that contrast is really interesting, from going from to just how many albums can you say have so many different kinds of genres and qualities, and it all fits so cohesively. And just in the song alone, you have this kind of thing. And then you also have a section that sounds like industrial metal. Another way that I find this song a bit disorienting, despite the fact that the drums are so consistent, there's a strong emphasis on the offbeats. So here's what the beat is, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So there are multiple types of offbeats. You can have 8th note offbeats, you can have 16th note offbeats, you could have 32nd note offbeats. In this case, we're gonna be hearing 8th note offbeats and 16th note offbeats. So here's what they sound like. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, and, 4. Well, that was annoying. The 16th note offbeats, however, are even more disorienting because they fall in between offbeats, 8th note offbeats. Did that throw you a little bit? Was it sort of like you felt like maybe the downbeat was somewhere else? If so, that's normal. Let's just look at the drum beat itself. Made of clay. I feel I'm the only one who thinks this way. So it just ends that snare, and there's this big gap. It's not really that big, but it feels massive. So I found out that the drums were produced by looping a sample of some beats made by Steve Perkins, who was the drummer for Porno for Pyros, which, wow, that was a lot of P's. I haven't heard any of their music, But that does give the song a little bit of an organic feel, even though the loop is so exact and well-structured. So there's just this, again, like kind of beautiful marriage of like organic sounds and mechanized sounds. This drum beat to me feels so unique. If someone were to play it note for note, I'd be like, you are sampling. I do not want this. And I know it doesn't actually work that way. You can't copyright rhythms. And there is a similar stress pattern in this Twilight and maybe some other Nine Inch Nails songs, but it's not exactly the same. There's such a dynamic quality to this song too. One way is with this noise that goes and it really feels like that to me, like something it gets bigger and bigger and then it goes back. It's sort of this like an exact same feeling I get from the drums when they sort of get more epic and bigger. They process them in such an amazing way, going from sounding very dry and almost meek and humble to being like all powerful. And this is going to sound so weird, but there have been times in my life where I'm having a very intense experience, and in my like mind's eye, I see like an abstract shape. It's different every time, and it gets big and small at random, just like these sounds do in my head. So I think that's another reason why it feels like it's in my neurology.
I'm always falling down the same hill, bamboo puncturing the skin, and nothing comes bleeding out of me, just like a waterfall I'm drowning in. 2 feet below the surface, I can still make out your wavy face. And if I could just reach you, maybe I could leave this place.
It sounded like sort of a stream of consciousness, sounded like someone's personality like shifting from one place to another. And it just reminded me like, oh, that's how the voice in my head sounds a lot of the time. You know, especially the second part where he says, and maybe this is a cry for help, or and maybe I don't have a choice, and maybe, and it just sort of gets interrupted, and it sounds like he can't even keep up with his thoughts.
You would know, wouldn't you? You extend your hand to those who suffer, to those who know what it really feels like, to those who've had a taste like that means something, and oh, so sick I am. Maybe I don't have a choice, and maybe that is all I have, and maybe this is a cry for help.
It just felt really, again, really visceral. But if I do listen to what he's actually saying, I mean, it is really interesting. There's a lot of imagery here. And just the line, I do not want this, felt so straightforward. You know, very innocent almost, like a child. I do not want this. When he screams, you don't know just how I feel. Oh, man. Don't you tell me how I feel. Don't you tell me. Let's talk about some noises. There's a sound that reminds me of a sonar. That's not exactly the rhythm, but it's syncopated and it's on the A, which is the fourth degree, which we were kind of talking about before. Just not the most tense interval, but still tense. Still pulling somewhere, still feeling kind of like, where are we again? I really, really love that touch. It's so gentle in some ways, and it's just pinging, and it won't. It just repeats and repeats and repeats. Listen to some of this sound design. It reminds me more of a horror film or a suspense thriller, which we've heard in other songs on the Downward Spiral before. But this is part of, again, another reason why I think this kind of bypasses the intellectual for me, is that there's some very evocative noises here that just set my nervous system on edge. Take a listen. Now there's this rhythmic noise, which has kind of got a pretty good low end. It's really interesting. I love listening to it just by itself, and it's something that I wasn't able to hear very well in the whole mix. But listen to how it drops in and out when the drums do their thing, where they get really big. It's sort of like playing with that, and it's making things feel like, again, the bottom is falling out, losing ground over and over again in a somewhat haphazard way, unpredictable. There's uneven phrasing at the end of this section. So even though I'm not counting, and you probably aren't either, like how many measures have gone by, our bodies are pretty good at getting a sense of what 4 and 8 feels like. And so when things aren't even, you might feel it, like something's a little off. And that would always happen to me. It's not a full 16 bars. So, which I love, because it's like, they let the noise do what it needed to do for as long as it took. And then they went to the next thing. Didn't feel the need to even it out and do like another couple measures just so that we felt like, ugh. And at the end of that section, there's this guitar, I think, that comes in with really strong distortion and really strong overtones. I don't even know if it's the fundamental frequency or an overtone, but I hear a really strong major third. There's really a strong sense of tonal center at that point, so it's really kind of weird to hear those two notes repeating in octaves. And that rhythm, wow, 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 and then it comes back in on the tonic in the guitar. This build is really intense, and it starts with his voice kind of whispering, but he's got a filter on it, and it sounds like pebbles to me, like really, really highly textured. And anytime there's a filter on his voice, it just reminds me of like, yeah, like this is a part of him, or it's outside of him. It's not really who he is. It's a part that's trying to control him. And that definitely ties into how I feel every time I hear these lyrics. It sounds like delusions of grandeur, and I couldn't quite relate to this part. But when he says, I want to do something that matters, that's when I would be like, okay, I'm back with you, Trent. I didn't really feel connected for those other lines. There's also a falsetto that's layered on top of the whispering on this kind of second repetition that I didn't notice before. It's really pretty. And this rhythm also echoes the drum rhythm. When the outro happens, there's a guitar line that comes in, and there's a special note in it that really sticks out to me. And that note is the natural 6, which is the C sharp. Now there's a slide in there that I can't play on the piano, so just be aware of that. So what's interesting about that riff is, wow, it just sounds so Nine Inch Nails to me. And here's why I think it does. First of all, the tone. The tone of this guitar reminds me of so many tracks on The Fragile, and still to this day, I think Trent is using this tone because I was just listening to Ghosts 5 together, and I recognize that tone on some other songs. I think. I'm not a guitarist, so I don't know for sure, but I got that feeling. But also, in terms of just the pitches, and even the syncopation. So he's starting on the flat 7, which is an unstable interval, going to the natural 6, which is also unstable, going to the second degree, which is also unstable, before just sort of barely resolving at the end. So it's just unstable, unstable, unstable resolution. And he's starting on the unstable interval, and that's another part. And just the fact that he's sort of layering what I would call like a Dorian scale on top of something that hasn't really had any sixths, but also it's on the offbeats for the most part. Did you hear that? So these are all anticipating the beat. Okay, but back to his voice. So when things are building and building and building, and he's finally getting to the point where he really is delivering this message with a lot more power, another voice comes in way up high. I wanna know everything. Singing that minor third really, really clearly, and this is also very much orienting us in E. And remember, the drums have not stopped this whole time, and then they stop right at the end, just in time for him to scream, "Matters." I wanna be-